अवेलेबल फॉर यू। ओके लेट्स स्टार्ट। अवर टूडेज लेक्चर फॉर बेसिक वर्कशॉप्स वी विल कवर टू टॉपिक्स इन दिस। फर्स्ट टॉपिक इज अ क्वालिटी कंट्रोल एंड सेकेंड टॉपिक विल बी इंजीनियरिंग मटीरियल्स। सो लेट्स फर्स्ट स्टार्ट विद क्वालिटी कंट्रोल। इन क्वालिटी कंट्रोल वी विल जस्ट सी, यू कैन सी इंट्रोडक्शन वट इज़ क्वालिटी कंट्रोल, बट बिफोर दैट वी विल सी वट इज़ क्वालिटी एंड बिफोर क्वालिटी वी विल सी विच थिंग्स those make the quality. And being engineers are mostly mechanical or industrial or other engineers, in fact these are the measurements. Our measurements tell us they are good quality things or bad quality things. So we will move step by step forward. Yes, session is recorded, session is recorded, it is already there. Okay Yazid, session is being recorded, so there is no issue. I already start the recording. So these are the textbooks, you can consult them if you need it, but as I told you, my lecture slides will be enough to get good marks in the exam. So concentrate on the slides, but for further details you can consult these slides, these books. Let's first start with the measurements. In basic engineering we always have measurements. Measurements mean there are some basic dimension, for example length, mass, time, temperature, angle, etc. We need to measure them. In fact these are not just these items are, there are a lot of things we need to measure. For example we need to measure power, we need to measure torque, we need to measure many engineering quantities, and we need many devices. So different devices are there to measure the different quantities, and moreover in one quantity, for example temperature measurement, you can use bulb type thermometer, you can use some electrical assisted thermometers. So depending upon the quality of the instrument, depending upon the quality of your output, so you can again select how much quality you want. Anyhow, for example linear dimensions, for linear dimensions there are well known instruments, those we use for measurement, ruler are there, caliper there, micrometer, vernier caliper, dial gauges. I will only say Ahmed Ali, might be voice problem is at your end, only you are having problem, but two things are there. Lecture is recorded, so at any time you can go and check the recording, so my voice will be available for you on the recording. Okay, there should be no issue. So and definitely slides are also there, so I have to move forward. Thank you. So mass, so these are the linear measurements. Then the mass can be measured by mechanical balance, spring balance, to you can say popular systems, you also have seen them in your many daily life applications. Then force measurement, you can use spring method, coil method, strain gauge methods. These strain gauge methods are used in mechanical engineering to plot stress strain graphs. There is also one system which is called load cell to measure the force. Then torque measurements, brakes method is used, dynamometer methods are used, strain or transducer methods are also used. So you need to don't know at this stage, you don't need to go in much details of these instruments, measurement devices, just to know the names. These names are used, or these are the devices names, those are used to measure the certain quantities. Here for example ruler, we use ruler to measure the linear dimensions, but why we use them? For example this type of ruler, we use it when we need to make long measurements, but precision or accuracy is not required. When you're going to make a dimension of your room or building heights, you use these kind of things, but again the accuracy or precision is not as high, because you can see 1 millimeter, but what is between 1 millimeter, 0.1 millimeter, might be you cannot measure with this one. So but definitely in our life we need to make many rough measurements, then these are very cheap methods. Rulers are very affordable methods to measure the dimensions. Calipers. Calipers are another devices. Those help us to assist the linear measurements. Why we use them? For example, I cannot use my ruler directly to measure the inside diameter. So what I do, I will put this caliper inside. I will open it like this compass, and then where it will stop, I will lock it, and then I will put it on the ruler to measure the dimension. So you can say again, ruler is there, but this time ruler cannot directly measure inside diameter. So we use them caliper. So caliper will help them to measure the inside. Similarly, caliper can also help them to measure the outside diameter. Again, I don't know when I will place my ruler, where it will be placed. It will be placed here, 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 where it will be placed. So it will can cause problem. So again, this problem can be reduced by using a caliper. We will open the caliper just like compass, and we will lock where we will get the maximum diameter. Then we will place it on the ruler to measure the dimensions, just like here or just like there. Or for more precise, we can also put our calipers on micrometers, vernier calipers, etc., to measure the reading. Feeler gauges. Feeler gauges, precision machine piece of metal. These are round shapes. They are in millimeter system. They are also in inch system, whatever they are available. So what are the purpose of feeler gauges? They used to confirm the space gaps between two things. For example, if there are two things, they are placed on each other. Most of the time, when you look at them, it looks like there is no gap between them. Yes, in reality, there is a very little gap between them that you cannot see. So in that case, we take out one feeler gauge and insert. If it is, for example, I have taken out a feeler gauge whose width thickness is 0.1. If 0.1 is going inside, we can say gap is 0.1. But again, I tried with 0.2. If 0.2 is going inside, I can say gap is 0.2. Then again, I try with 0.3. If 0.3 is not going inside, I can say gap is greater than 0.2 at less than 0.2. So they are quick methods to measure the gaps between the flat objects. For example, this is the case which is the cylinder head. This is cylinder head. Cylinder head is very precise instrument and very expensive instrument. When there are different parts, those are going to meet or mate with here on this part. So in order to wire the gaps between them, they should be flat. How we ensure the flatness? We place a very good bar on it and insert a feeler gauge. If feeler gauge is going inside, we will say there is a gap between the two parts. So engine head is not perfectly flat. So if engine head is not flat, what will happen? A liquid can leak from here. Water can leak from here. And once the leakage happens, engine will be destroyed. So we need to check the flatness, and the most easy, affordable and quick method is the feeler gauge. These feeler gauges are available with your local mechanic even. If you have time, go and check them. If they are working on engine and flatness, might be they will be using it in front of you. Another instrument, very popular instrument, which is used for measurements is micrometers. So micrometers are available in normally this kind of shape. They are used to measure the outside, this is outside micrometer. So this, it is having a clamp. So this is a clamp. So we can put our particle here, and then we need to rotate this part, dash it, and then we can take our reading. But it cannot give us easy reading measurement like ruler or rulers or other things. We need a technique. This is a technique, means least count as other things, and we to learn the technique to measure the or read the reading from it. So it is not direct, but you need to know. Definitely some other lectures or other subjects you will learn it in the labs. Where we use a micrometer, where again precision requirement is high. So for example, this piston cylinder head, or head outside diameter is very precise and control thing, because it is used in very critical applications. So we will, rather than using a ruler classical, we will prefer a micrometer to measure its dimension. Another instrument, which is also accurate, a good instrument after a micrometer, is called vernier caliper. Vernier caliper is very popular and used by very mechanics around the world. It has served many advantages. For example, these two jars, you can use them to measure the inside diameter. Inside, you place one cylinder here, so it will give you outside measurement. If you want to measure inside, if you want to measure outside diameter, place something here. If you want to measure inside diameter, place something here. If you want to measure the depth of anything, how much it is deep, you can place it here and extend. It will measure the depth. So depth, inside diameter, outside diameter, very, you can say, versatile instrument. Again, you need a practice to take a reading from it. It has two scales, main scale and vernier scale. Then with the combination of main and vernier scale, you can take the reading. Now we will move towards quality, but before quality, we need to understand two basic difference. One, they are introduced two basic definitions. One, it is called precision, and other is called accuracy. What is accuracy? First, accuracy tells you how much your answer is close to the actual or true value. For example, actual value is 5, but your answer is 6, 7, 8, 5.9. So nothing is close to actual value. When nothing is close to actual value, we will say there is not much accuracy. So accuracy, when we define, we need to know if it is close to actual value. Then another term is called precision. Precision does not care about the actual value. For example, actual value is 5, but your answer is 6, 6.1, 5.9, 6.05. If you check here, all these things are very close to each other, very close to 6, 6, 6.1, 5.9. So they are very close to each other, although they are away from true value. When values, you take measurements, they are close to each other, they are called precision. And when they are close to actual value, they are called accuracy. Here, example, easy example. For example, we know this is my target point. If I throw arrows, we can say arrows are far, far away from true value. So there is no or very few accuracy. But we can see one more thing. All the arrows are very close to each other. Yes, they have good precision, but they have less accuracy. Then, second example. Now you can see your arrows are much closer to the target value, all these, they are close to the target or so yes, they are high in accuracy, but now you can see they are away from each other, so low in precision. This is the third case. Not only every arrow is close to the original value, target value, but they are also close to each other, so high precision, high accuracy. In fact, we are looking for quality. Accuracy plus precision both give us quality. Because we want to control quality control, we want to have things with quality. So if we ensure accuracy and if we ensure precision, we can have a quality products. And if there is an error in the system, it is also a function of precision and quality. Means if there is a less accuracy, it means it is error. If it is less precision, it means there is error. And whenever we go for accuracy and precision, it means there will be more money involved. Definitely, when you purchase, for example, a Ford car, when you purchase Lamborghini, when you purchase a Mercedes, they are expensive. Still, they are cars. They have four tires. You need to travel over them, but they are expensive than Toyota or Suzuki cars. Why? Because they have more quality products. So you are paying for the quality as well. So if you increase the quality, cost will also increase. So they are related to each other. So here is one ref. For example, you are measuring some outside diameter. There are 100 parts. For 100 parts, you are measuring the outside diameter. When you plot them, you check their readings values fall here, 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 all the values. Their value and probability of that value on the vertical axis. So all the values are here. So if this is the average of all the spread, since what is accuracy? Accuracy was any value when it is compared with true or reference value. It gives you accuracy. And what is precision? How values are close to each other. It is called precision. So precision. So if my spread is like this, more skew, this is more precise. If my spread is something like this, it is less precise. Although average is same, accuracy is same, but it is less precise. But if I have another curve, for example, which is here. So now difference from here to here is less than this. So this one is more accurate than this. So this is how precision, which is spread, and accuracy, they are related to the quality of the product. Now, if there is less precision, less accuracy, it means there are errors in the system. So sources of errors can be many. They will affect, sources of errors can be many. For example, worker is not working good. There is a light issue. There is a machine problem. And many problems can be reason. And errors can be due to less accuracy, less precision, less resolution. Then we can use proper mathematical models to measure the errors. So confidence intervals should be there, which are based on means or proportion. Confidence intervals can be there, might be, it's like this, that. Confidence interval is that there is a higher, for example, here, it has very less probability that you have quality product. As you are moving towards the center, you have more probability. So your confidence of interval will be high. How much probability is that you will have much high quality products? So how many measurements you need to have desired level of errors? So number of measurements. Here, now we are moving towards quality. We need to know who is basically responsible for quality. Everyone in the organization. In the future, you will go to industry. In the industry, you will see everybody is with their organization, personal working inside. If equipment is good, quality product. Equipment is bad, bad quality. Purchasing. If you are purchasing good raw material, you will have good products. So process control means your manufacturing process are in good. They are done by good machines, good processes. Your information management is good. It can be like, you can say, might be marketing department. They are giving instrument that people demand is this. So you will, if you incorporate people demand into products, you have good products, quality products. So documents and records. The more you keep documents, the more you keep records, it will help you to achieve quality. Management, assessment that your products are good or not good. They will give you assessment. So everybody in the industry is responsible for quality. Now we will move towards the definition of quality. Proper. What is definition of quality? Fitness of use. Okay. I am using a shirt. It gives me very comfortable fitness. So, okay. For shirt, it is fitness of food. Conformance to the requirement. He says, somebody says, I give them drawing. Everything is as per drawing. So my definition of quality is this. Okay, fine. This is your definition of quality. Another third says, no. My definition of quality is that degree of excellence. When I use a product it gives me a lot of comfort. So this is its definition of quality. So performance exceeding expectations. We were surprised that this is a lot more comfortable than was expected. So there can be many definitions of quality depending upon the situation. For example, if you are in airport, what is the airport quality? Aeroplanes are coming and going on time. So timing might be quality criteria at airport. If you go visit the hospital, what is the hospital quality criteria? Might be your appointments as per your times. You are not, you don't need to wait there. So it is their quality measurement. So you can see it is different. If you are listening music, so good pitch, good sounds. So that is quality measurement. So different fields have different quality definitions, but more or less they have same objective. So this is a proper definition given in here in standard, but you have now idea that quality features and characteristics of a product or service that bear on its ability to satisfy the needs. So if you have needs and this is a product that satisfying the needs as per the characteristics, those were required, those were incorporated features, so it will give me quality product. So again, responsibility of quality, main thing is to satisfy the customer. In order to satisfy the customer, marketing, design and engineer, then procurement, then process design, then production, then inspection, packing, delivery. So you can see from marketing to delivery, everybody come and will put its effort to make a quality product and so to make a customer satisfied. Now we will see what is quality control. Quality control are the methods and techniques to achieve quality, to sustain quality, and to further improve quality. So this is a slight difference between quality and quality control. Quality is that, for example, somebody says, "What this hospital has better quality than other hospital." What is that quality? When we visit that hospital, the waiting time for the one patient is about 1 minute. In the other hospital, it is 10 minutes. Yes, surface in the first hospital is quality service because we only have to wait 1 minute. Then what is quality control? Quality control is that they further want to reduce the 1 minute to 30 seconds. So they further want to improve the quality. So this is quality control. Quality control means what is original target, achieve it. Then secondly, to maintain it. If 1 minute wait is the quality control criteria, don't increase it to one after 1 minute. Means don't let it increase 2 minutes, 3 minutes. Sustain it. Achieve 1 minute. Sustain 1 minute, don't let be to go it beyond 1 minute, or finally improve it. Improving means reduce to 30 seconds, 20 seconds. So these are techniques are quality controls. Quality control means having a control on the quality. So there it integrates many important things. Specifications needed, design of the product, it is going to meet the requirements or not, or specifications we designed. If these specifications are in the design, then whatever is placed in the design, manufacturing is able to achieve that design. If whatever we are able to manufacture, inspection will check whatever is made, it is as per production methods, and at the end we will review that all things we have done properly, proper documentation will be there. So all these things will help to achieve the quality, to sustain the quality, and then to improve the quality. So this is quality control. So how we improve the quality control, or how we measure the quality control, is says normally these are methods. They are called statistical methods. For example, statistical methods means one of them is TQM, bigger method, collection and data. So we need to collect data, we need to use some methods to check them. So two major parts, statistical control charts, acceptance sampling techniques, they can help us. So variable data type charts means you measure length or you measure weight or you measure height, you measure something. Other type of data is available. And rather than measuring something, you say, okay, product is good or product is bad. So might be this is the criteria. Here you are not measuring qualitatively like this, but you are just saying it's okay product or it's not okay. You are not going much details. So control charts are help us to improve the quality. In fact, control charts are tell us the variation in the data. For example, this is my data plot. If I my one product is here, other is here, other is here, third one is here, fourth is here. So this chart is telling me this is not good product, this is not good product, so other are good. So this chart is helping me to keep a record. Normally these charts are available on the shop floor and it will give you, for example, if my chart is like this and finally it moves very close to center line. So my trend is going like this. It is telling me quality control is active and my product is close to center line. On the other hand, if my chart is something like this, it is giving me idea. My quality control is telling me manufacturing and there's some problem. Quality is disturbing. So have a control. So charts give us direct hint to control it, and they are placed on the shop floor. There are many types of charts. Variable charts, we already discussed to measure something. Attribute charts means we need to know this is good, this is not good product. They are further divided on C and P type chart. Then variable charts in which we measure something, they are classified into two charts, average chart or range chart. So you will see the details in your future classes. So we already discussed that how control chart helps us data. One point is here, other point is here. This is the lower limit, this is upper limit, and we can see this is center, and we can see okay, this is the only product which is going above the outer limit. So this chart, this one also. So we can go and investigate what happened here, why these two are outside the limits. So this is the chart which is helping us to maintain the quality. Another same chart, but now it is, we already discussed variable chart is average type and range type. So average, we measure the average of a group. For example, this is the E, this is the value of a group. For example, in group there were 10 measurements. The average of 10 measurements here, the average of next group is there, average of next 10 groups is 10 measurements is there. So in each group there are 10 products. So one group average value, other group, third group, fourth group, fifth, sixth, seventh group. So this is the average. And what is range means? The difference between the maximum and the minimum within a group. So range chart. So we can plot range charts. Here this graph telling me this fourth group is fails in, and this group fails in average value. Otherwise range is okay, and this one fail in the range graph. So this will give us hint that how my production is going towards good or going towards not good, and we can check and take necessary measuring actions. For example, this is my spread of data. Here we can see initial data was spread was this in the January, then in the February spread reduces. It means take notice this spread and we done some quality efforts. So spread of data is reduced in January. Even in here in the July it is further reduced. So clearly trend is going something like this, converging. So quality control is active, quality is good. So this is the average, same this is the range. So this type of charts help us to check our quality. There is another technique to measure that is called acceptance sampling. What is acceptance sampling? For example, I will say you make 1,000 parts in 1 hour, only 1 hour, and you want to check them. Might be manufacturing is consuming less time. If you will check them, it will take more time. For example, this is one screw. I know in screw there is a head, there is a tear, this is screw shank, there are threads. So there is a diameter, there is a length, there is a width. So there are 10 dimensions in one screw. this screw is made in only 1 minute. 1 minute. But if I'm going to check all the dimensions, might be it will take 10 to 15 minutes. So I am wasting my more time on checking rather than manufacturing. So here checking will waste my time. So here I will not go for 100% checking, but in fact I will go for sampling. We will discuss sampling. There is another possibility of sampling. Destructive testing. What is destructive testing? For example, you make a rocket, and then how you will test the rocket? You will fire the rocket, fine. After firing, you can say this rocket was good. Then what about second rocket? Again, you will fire the rocket and will say, okay, that rocket was also working well. But you will waste all your rockets. You cannot waste all your rockets by checking them. So this is destructive testing. Again, we will go for sampling plan. So now what is sampling plan? For example, if there is destructive testing required, or when there are a huge quantity of products are there, for example, 1,000, among 1,000, we will select randomly only 20 parts. And we will check on only 20 parts. And we will make our decision on the basis of 20 parts. So this is called sampling technique. Sampling technique means if you manufacture 10,000, out of 10,000, you will only check 100. And on the basis of 100, you will make the decision for all the 10,000. And might be you can accept all 10,000, might be you reject all 10,000. So this is the reason where we'll go for sampling. Another reason for sampling is that fatigue. Might be if you keep on checking same thing again and again and again, might be you will get bored. So these are few things. When last number of things are there, when there is a destructive testing required, where fatigue or boredom is there, when cost of checking is more high, then you can go for sampling. So what happens in sampling? We already discussed. This is a big lot. For example, 1,000 parts. Out of 1,000, you only selected, for example, 50 parts, and you will make decision on the basis of 50 parts. This is called sampling. So acceptance sampling is applied when there is a destructive testing required. We already discussed that. You want to check a fuse, you destroy it. You want to check a sample, tensile test means destroy the part. You want to check cigarette. How you will check your cigarette is good in the factory? You will smoke the cigarette in the factory, but you will smoke all the cigarettes? No. Sampling. When 100% cost is very high, means manufacturing cost might be low, but inspection cost is high. Normally it is economical. So these are this. So acceptance sampling, what you do, you will take random sample. For example, if there is 1,000 parts, you will check random. You will pick any 20 parts. You will accept or reject these 1,000 parts on the basis of these 20 parts. So what is lot sentencing means? This is called lot sentencing, in which you will take a sample, in which you make decisions, then accept all the lot, means all 1,000 parts with no inspection, because you only measure 20 parts. Or you can say 20 parts, show them they were not good products. So maybe you can give a decision, being a quality control engineer, measure all 1,000. Or acceptance sampling, you can go for sampling techniques, second sampling, third sampling, like this. Advantages of sampling: less expensive, reduced damage. When you're measuring less things, it means reduced damage, less things. So reduce errors. Disadvantages: there's always a chance some bad products will go in the market, because out of 1,000, you only measure 50. So remaining 950, there's a chance some bad will go out. So less information generated, definitely information is generated only for 50 parts. So we need some planning and other techniques. There can be single sampling, double sampling, multiple sampling. What is single sampling means? You take a sample of 20 and you are not satisfied. You will say, I am not satisfied with single sampling. So what you request, you will say, I will take a second sample to make my decision. Might be again, you are not satisfied with the second sample. So this is double sampling plan. You go for third sample, fourth sample, means multiple sampling. Sometimes you take your decision on single sample, single sampling. Sometimes you are not satisfied, you go for another second sampling, double, and sometimes you go for multiple sampling. Now, what is sampling? This is a sampling technique. For example, there is 1,000 parts. In order to make decision, you only selected sample size of 20. And it will be mentioned in the standard. You will measure R20 parts, acceptance number is C, which is, for example, 5. 5 says, out of 20, maximum 5 parts can be bad or rejected parts. Bad or rejected parts. 15 must be, 15 or more must be okay. If 15 or more are okay, lot is accepted. Or, in other words, maximum defected pieces should be 5. For example, if defect piece 4, lot is accepted, 3, lot is expected, 5, lot is expected. But when I check 20 parts and there are 6 bad pieces, defect pieces, then I will say no. I will not accept this lot. Might be I will reject, I will take second sample or anything. So this is sampling. So we already discussed there are N items. We will take a sample and we will see a acceptance rejection on this C. So it is just explained. So this is a sampling technique. Out of a sample, I will take randomly 20 parts. I will inspect 20 parts. And for example, I have found 3 pieces. I will discard 3 pieces and put 3 good pieces, because out of 23 were bad pieces. I will put them. So now I will go back remaining lot. If I will see, if, for example, defective piece should be 5 was my criteria. If this C, we have found defective, these 3, these not 3, but in fact, these are 5 pieces, for example. So defective pieces are 5, my criteria was 4. So defective pieces are more than the defined criteria, so I will reject the lot. But in other case, since defective pieces are 4, but says maximum defective pieces are 4, C is 4, but my major defective pieces are 3. So 3 is less than 4. In this case, I will accept the lot. So this is called sampling technique. So this is all these things will help us to improve the quality control. So in the quality control, what is done to maintain the quality, to improve the quality? For the quality control, we need to know how we can measure, how we can control. So we can make statistical charts, we can do sampling plans, and this is how our quality can go outside. So then quality introduction definitions, you should be have high accuracy precision. In order to have accuracy and precision, you need to do measurements. And for measurements, you need to do some instruments. So this is the first topic which we have covered today. If you have any question, you can ask me now regarding this quality control methods. Any question you have? Ahmad Yazid Abdullah, you are okay. Remember, recordings are available for you, and you can check them. I have made them easy for you. So okay, everybody is satisfied. I will move towards second part. No question, moving to second part. Second part is engineering materials. Engineering material, how many engineering materials are there? There are a lot of engineering materials. So there are certain criterias to select the materials. We cannot use same material everywhere. So there are a lot of criterias to selection of the material. In this lecture, we will just see introduction, some selection criteria. So introduction to engineering materials. There are many types of engineering materials. And all the materials used in engineering applications can be basically divided into 6 categories. Pure materials. Many metals are pure materials. Then alloys, in which we mix metals or we mix non-metals to produce alloys. Alloys are mixtures. We can have polymers. Polymers mean the plastic, rubbers you use in your life. They are polymers. There can be ceramics, the tiles of your room, they are ceramic materials, road, concrete, they are ceramic materials, composites. In composite, we mix epoxy with the fibers like glass fiber, carbon fiber. They are called composites. Composites mean mixing two things such that they remain separate, but they are mixed. For example, your bridge. Your bridge is a mixture of concrete and metallic rods. So your bridge is also a composite material for engineering, civil engineering applications. Composite materials are very popular in aeroplanes, in cars, because they are lightweight and they are more strong. Then modern materials like many machining modern like CD player materials, smart materials, organic inco, many other materials. So we can divide them into many other parts materials. Materials, we use different materials depending upon them. Here is an aeroplane, A381, very popular aeroplane. It, you can see it has different materials in different locations. It is used carbon fiber, aramid fiber, glass fiber, or some hybrid or some metals. Here tip, we know tip is the one which is directly faces the air drag. So it should have more friction against heat and air, different materials. Here tips of the wings are going to have more drag. So these tips, so we will apply different materials at different locations depending upon the applications. Depending upon the applications, different materials have different weight, different strength. So you can see everywhere different types of materials are used. This example, most of the materials, those are implied are fibers, composite materials. So in fact, now composite materials are replacing metallic materials because they are more, you can say, they are lightweight and at the same time, they are more strong. So different applications, you have different materials. How we make our criteria to select the material? Cost. One criteria, you want to purchase high expensive material or less expensive material, your choice. Mechanical properties, some materials are very good, have properties, some materials have bad properties. What is your requirement? You want good property, fine, go for good property, but remember, might be good property is more or less expensive. Reduce weight. You want to select a material heavy weight or lightweight. If I am designing aeroplane, I would like to design lightweight material. Might be light material is more expensive, good properties, so I will consider it. Durability, which material has long life? I don't want to replace my material after every 6, every 2 or 3 years. I want my material that is long life material. Again, long life material might be more expensive. Environmental effect means rain, sun. Material should be able to withstand environmental effects. So you can see many of things you need to consider when you select your material. Our selection of materials depend upon behavior of and manufacturing properties of materials. So what different criteria? Structure of material is one thing that depend, that give us what is the behavior, what will be the behavior of material. Structure of material mean I will be discussing atoms, atomic bonds, metallic bond, ionic bond, covalent bonds. So you can see it is a chemistry branch, chemical engineering branch. Then we can for physics, physical and chemical properties. What is the melting point? What is the density? What is the specific heat? What is the thermal conductivity? So these properties we need to know if we want to select a good material based on physical properties. Then mechanical properties. What is the strength of the material? Ductility, elasticity, hardness, toughness, freak. So there are many properties. Then modification of properties also there that can help. How we modify properties? Normally materials are metallurgical engineers come here. They perform heat treatment. What is heat treatment? Annealing, tempering, normalizing. So these are many, many, many heat treatment materials. Those can be techniques can be applied to further improve the property of the materials. Composites, we can take different mixtures. Different mixture of materials will give us different properties. How we can get the properties of material in mechanical engineering? Most of the time we take a tensile test. In tensile test, we hold a sample between two jaws and we stretch them. So this is tensile test specimen. After stretching, we can get the properties. For example, if we stretch a material, we can have this type of curve of the material, linear, non-linear. Linear is the elastic part. Non-linear is plasticity part. Plasticity means once deformation is done, it will never go back. In elastic part, after deforming, you can go up, you can even come back. But once you go there, you never go back to zero. In fact, if you remove the load, you will come back here. You will come back here, but you will never go back zero. So plasticity, here it will give you what is the maximum strength. It will tell you what is the fracture point. It will tell you what is the yield point which separates elastic from the plastic. It will also tell you what is the total fracture energy. Fracture energy is area under the curve, total fracture energy. It will also tell you what is the stiffness or elastic energy area under only this point. So this curve will give you lots of information. A very popular formula is used that can be applied to linear. Linear means this portion only, this. This is called elastic portion. This formula is valid here, but this formula is not valid in the plasticity. So plasticity part and elastic part, and in the elastic part, this formula is valid. Elastic means if you apply a load, stress will increase, but if you remove the load, it will come back to its original place. We already discussed this thing that this is a stress strain curve, elastic part in which there is elastic region. Then there is a yield point. Yield point is a point which separates elastic from the plastic. This is the maximum stress here, ultimate strength. This is the fracture here. What is this projected curve if necking had not occurred? In fact, when we stretch a material, its cross section changes in the middle when it is elongated. So it is called necking. When you apply a force, that diameter which was initially constant is no more constant, but diameter is reducing. He says if necking had not been considered, it should go like this. If necking is considered, behavior is like this. So sometime we take constant cross-sectional area to measure the stress strain, and sometime we take actual criteria to measure the stress strain curve. There can be tensile stress, there can be shear stress. Shear stress normal to the plane, shear plane. So you can also have the tensile test, you can also have shear stress. There can be other tests to measure the hardness. Hardness is one of the most important properties. What is hardness? It is the resistance to indentation. What we do, this is my sample material. We press something inside it. The resistance to penetration is called hardness. Hardness is a good important property. So hardness as generally means material resistance to scratching and wear. So if material is hard, it will good material and it will not wear and it will not be able to scratch. So many tooling, for example, my cutting tools, my drill tools, normally they are hard. So very good property to have and to measure. So hard ball is pressed into the specimen with a lot of force. Force of 500, 1500 up to 3000 kilograms. We are now checking the material property, but with temperature. Temperature affects the property. So you can see yield strength is decreasing. Strength and tensile strength is decreasing as temperature is increasing. What is the yield strength? If this is my stress strain curve, this point which separates elastic from plastic is called yield, and the maximum strength, maximum point of stress is called tensile strength. So both are decreased when temperature is increased, but ductility increased. What is ductility? Ductility is that if material, if we stretch a material and its dimension or its length is increased a lot, it is called ductile material. But if I stretch a material and it breaks quickly, for example, up to this it breaks, so it is less ductile material. So ductile materials deform more than brittle materials. So we know when on heat that some materials become soft, and soft materials stretch more, so ductility increase. There is a history of civilization that we use materials, because today we are using metals, composites, but in the past we were not using them. So in the past, humans once started to use stones as a material, so it is called Stone Age. Then they discovered a metal material which is called bronze. So Bronze Age material, it also lasts for 300-400 years. It also lasted many hundred years. Then modern age started from early, you can say 18th century, Iron Age. This is the time when we discovered a lot of materials based on iron, and we made different alloys and steels. Lot of factories, components of cars, airplanes, they were made. Then later stage, advanced materials. Now we are making advanced materials, composites, temperature sensitive materials, CD materials, many other materials. Now we know one thing, we are always looking for materials, but why? What is looking? What we are looking? Why we always keep on looking the materials? Why we always keep on changing the materials? What is our wish? So in fact, before going that, if there is a strength, there is a material A and there is a material B. Material A is strong material, material B is weak material. So which material you want to choose? Definitely you will go for strong material. There's another material C and D. And which this C material is a heavy material. D material is very lightweight material. So which material you will select? Definitely you will select lightweight material. Easy to lift, so take less fuel consumption. It means historically, if we want to select a material, we want a material which is very strong, and at the same time we would like to select a material which is also have less weight, low in weight but strong in strength. So we want a material which is strong in strength and which is less in weight. Okay, what is the measure of weight? How we will say something is lightweight, something is heavy? Density tells us, density of the material. If density is 1000, for example, of a water, another material which is density, for example, it is mercury density is 1300. So which material is heavy? This is heavy material, mercury. Which material is lightweight? Water is lightweight. So density tells us material is heavy material, material is lightweight material. So remember, being an engineer, if I ask you, I give you an assignment, please prepare a list of materials heavy and lightweight. So what will be your criteria? You will search for the density. Density tells us that it is a heavy material and it is a lightweight material. So it means we are looking for two things. We want a material which has high strength, and we want a material which has low density. Material high strength and low in density. So we are looking a ratio. Ratio is strength to density ratio. If strength to density ratio is high, this ratio is high, it is a good material. If this ratio is low, this is not a as good material. So this is what is happening. On the vertical axis, we have plotted strength to weight ratio, and these are years. We can see when we were using wood and stone, this ratio was very low. When we start bronze, this is high. We want this ratio high. Then iron age, then steel age, then composites. Composites are here. So composites are one, they have high strength and they have low weight. Then only fibers are even more than composites. They have much better strength and they are very lightweight material. So with the passage of time, this strength to weight ratio is increasing, because this is our target of the material. Next, properties. We will just look a few of the properties. What is property? Property is that when certain load and certain force or certain action is applied, on a material action. How material responds, what material respond, or what is material reaction? So from here we find our properties. For example, for mechanical engineer, we apply the load on the material. Load is force, and we check what is the elongation, what is the hardness, or what is the strength of the material. So we measure the properties. So specimen subjected to force will experience deformation, or optical properties. We throw a light on a material, light will come, and we will see either it passes through the material or it reflect back. So they will give us optical properties. These type of tests will give us deformation properties, mechanical properties. So there are many types of properties, but how we get a property under action, we will check the reactions. So properties can be classified into main six categories: mechanical, electrical, means we will see reflections, thermal. If material is a good insulator or bad insulator, thermal properties we need to know, magnetic properties, opticals, deteriorative related to chemical, means material can sustain long life or bad life, it deteriorates quickly or not quickly. Then being a mechanical engineers or mechanical or electrical, whatever, here is some basic mechanical properties are given. Strength, ability to bear, if material is strong before fracture, it is called strength. Ductility, ductility means stretching, deformation. If there is more stretching, more deformation under given load, it's called ductile material. Elasticity is the ability of the material to return to original shape if load is removed, elastic removed. Stiffness, stiffness is a property, resistance to elastic, how much it is resistance to elastic or recoverable. Young modulus of elasticity is the measure of stiffness. High stiffness material have high modulus. This hardness we already see, it is resistance to scratch or indentation. Toughness, resistance to elastic plastic deformation, means if there is elastic and plastic part, so toughness is the area under the curve, it is the limit. Material is tough, so this material is more tough because it is have more area under the curve than this curve. Fatigue, fatigue is very important property. It is a property in which applied load is not constant. In fact, applied load is changing with time. So it is called fatigue load. For example, in your lift, sometimes there is a 1%, some there are 10%, some there are 5%. It means lifts experiencing fatigue load. Fracture, fracture means separation. If two parts are separated, they are fractured. Fracture means there will be cracks, separation between the parts. So fracture is related to cracks and crack growth. Creep, creep is related to the load, high loads, but under high temperature. For example, if there is a part, it will expose to temperature. If we apply the load, and we'll see under 100 degree how it responds, then we will see at 200 degree how it responds. So we check the loads, but under temperature conditions, creep. So creep will be monitoring the property of applied, but under temperature. So these are few popular mechanical properties. We will just see some metals. We know metals are metallic. You can see aluminium, copper, titanium. What are the advantages in them? Atoms are properly arranged. Atoms are not random. In the metals, atom will be properly arranged at its locations. This is arrangement of atoms everywhere they properly locate. So these will give them more stiff. They have high modulus. They are strong, so they will not fracture at easily. They are ductile. Yes, we know. Metals can deform before fracture happening, so they have moderate fracture toughness values. Many examples of metals. Then ceramics. Ceramics are compounds between metal and metallic, non-metallic. What are ceramics? Your tiles at home, your bridges, clay, So these are the ceramic materials. They have our oxide nitrides. Advantages, they are very strong. They are very stiff. They are very hard, yes, but they are very brittle. You know that tiles which you use at home or bridges, once there is a crack, it spreads very quickly. So ceramic is that if you apply a load, if there is a crack, it completely spreads and break it. So this is called brittle behavior. Brittle behavior is that it will crack immediately if you apply a load. So they are brittle behavior. Metals are not brittle, they are ductile. So they are not as good for the fracture. Fracture means crack. Metals are good against fracture, but ductile, brittle or ceramics are not good against fracture. Main advantage is that they are insulators. This is the highest advantage. We can expose them to high temperatures and they will withstand the temperatures. And at the same time, they not transmit the temperature to other parts, means they are acting as insulators. So this is the excellent property, insulative properties, and they can also withstand environmental conditions. Unlike metals, if there is a rain, there is a high temperature, ceramics material, your tiles, which you put them on your house, on your roofs, on your walls, they can withstand them. And definitely they do not pass to the home as quickly as metals. So they are insulators. Many examples of ceramics. Polymers. Polymers are the one, those are plastic, rubber type materials. They are polycarbonate, polyethylene, many materials are there. They have main advantage, low density. Low density means they are lightweight. Their disadvantage is they are not strength and strong. We know polymers are not strong. Their other advantage, they are ductile, yes. They stretch are long. Pliable mean lot of plasticity, and we can put them in different shapes. This can be considered as advantage. They are inert to many chemical reactions sometimes. But their main disadvantage is that soft on high temperatures. They are very sensitive to temperature. If temperature is high, their properties deteriorate a lot. So this is the, you can say, not a good property because they are very sensitive to temperature. They are not conductor to electricity and they are not non-magnetic materials. Many polymer applications around us. Yes, then comes the composites. Very popular in defense industry, aeroplane industry, boats, car, everywhere now. Main thing is that they are the ideal to combine high strength and low density. So what we, how we make them? We make them by making a combination of two things, polymer epoxies plus fibers. Advantage is that they are stiff, they are strong, but little bit of disadvantage, they're expensive materials. For example, we use them in cars, we use them in rockets, we use them in aeroplanes, we use them in racing cars. Sometimes complete racing car, sometimes complete racing boat is made of composite materials. Then we just a graph. What is that? Density. You know what is density we want? We want a material which has low density. Low density makes it lightweight. We know metals are not have low densities, they are heavy things. Ceramics are have low densities than metals, than polymers. They also have low densities. Composites, you can see, they have further low densities. So when we check at the densities, composites are ideal materials. Then we check the strength. Strength means how much material is strong before fracture. Yes, metal have good strength. Ceramic have good but less than metals. You can see polymer does not have almost no strength. You look at here composites. They have high strength values. So you can see composites are very ideal. They have high strength and they have low density. So they combine the two properties which we want. So that's why they are being used more and more in modern industry. So more lot of composite materials, nozzles, UAVs, rockets. So defense industry, they are very popular. Advanced materials. Advanced materials mean modern materials. Those are made of high tech technology. They are called advanced materials. For example, your CD players, your CDs, your fiber optics, your computers, materials in the computers are some spacecraft materials. They are rocket military probe, so they are advanced materials. One of them is, for example, there are semiconductors. Semiconductors, they have properties between insulator and conductors. Very popular materials. They are mechanical and electric thermal properties are sometimes becomes very ideal. Then there are advanced material biomaterials, means materials those we can use inside the human bodies and they will not harm the human body. Metal can might harm us. Some polymers can harm us, but biomaterials are friendly to human bodies. So biomaterials, so they are not toxic to our body tissues. So advanced materials, smart materials, another type. Smart materials are those respond to temperature. Machines, if there is a high temperature, they give you different deformation behavior, and at low temperature they give you different temperature behaviors. So their shape changes mainly depending upon the temperature. So sensitive. Finally, nano engineer materials. For example, nano means you can understand we are playing at atomic level. If we are able to play at atomic level, we can replace the atom by another atom, or we can displace the position of an atom. So property of a material changes. So if we involve this kind of things, properties mean mechanical, electric, and other properties may change. So it means we are playing with nano engineered materials. Finally, sometimes we need a chart that can help us to select a material. For example, this is a chart which is with Young modulus and density. So normally, being an engineer, my target most of the time, I want a material which has high Young modulus and at the same time which has low density. So two things we can verify. So but anyhow, we will see what is the reality. You can see metals. Metals are have high stiffness, good, but metals are towards high density. High density means heavy material. So metals fall here. Ceramics, you can see very high strength, stiffness, but they are also towards here. Here is the composites, relatively low density and good things, a good strength, stiffness. You can see wood here. So wood looks to be very good when weight is here because it has low density, but wood is not good against stiffness. You can see stiffness are not as high as that of composites or metals. Polymers fall here, rubbers fall here, foam, you can see, has very lightweight, but foam is almost have very less stiffness. So these kind of charts are available. Those can help us to find, to locate a material if we want them. Okay, our introduction to engineering materials which we are looking for is also finished. And what was engineering materials? We need to know, in short, there are so many engineering materials and what are their properties and what are their selection criteria, cost, strength, stiffness, what are their properties. They have six properties: electrical, mechanical, optical, for another. Then among mechanical, we have seen there I have strength, hardness, stiffness, fatigue properties, creep properties. And then some selection criteria. We have seen metals. Metals are very strong because atoms are good depositions. They are stiff. They are ductile. We have seen polymers. We have seen composites and their properties. So this is how we have gone through some introduction to engineering materials. So I am going to now stop the